Everybody good? All right, let me throw this out.
Hey.
How you doing?
Oh wait, I have a mic right there. For a second, I was like, why don't I have
this
a mic?
This is a fake.
That's a total fake.
Well, it's a real mic.
Oh, okay.
But it's not, we can put it down here.
No, it's totally fine.
Or we can put it there.
I feel like
there.
We're on a TV talk
it is,
show.
It is. It's a fake fancy. TV talk show.
Okay,
yeah,
good.
It's a pretend TV talk show.
I'm doing well, I'm nervous.
Right.
I always get a little nervous. Yeah. I'm just being honest. I'm just gonna be a complete.
Well, everybody here is nervous.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Then I'm in good company.
The book
company.
Is great.
Thank you.
I wanna start with Jane Starr, the protagonist.
Okay.
And so here are the facts about her.
Okay.
She is 33. She's a one-hit wonder.
Yep.
And it's been several years since that hit. And she's feeling, at 33, over the hill.
Yeah.
And she has just been dumped.
Yeah.
For somebody, but by her boyfriend who's left for an actress in her
films. A lingerie model.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. And those are the facts. But what I find just absolutely fascinating and just what I love about the character is who she is, and that is she is insecure, mm-hmm. but at the same time she's always taking these bold risks.
Yeah.
She's sexy, but she also wears, in her words, granny underwear, or
yeah.
sometimes she calls it Soviet style underwear.
Yeah.
She's into all kinds of arts, but she's not pretentious. And she's clumsy a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Both with her words and just physically. And so I want to just tee it up with, did you know who this character was from the beginning, or did it develop over time?
That's a great question. I think it developed over time. You know, initially when I had the real spark, and Jackson Roach, are you in the audience somewhere?
Are you here? Right?
Yeah, there he is. So Jackson was the one, after I had co-written a bunch of screenplays that were optioned by studios but ended up in what we call development
which
hell,
happens, right?
Which means they get thrown in a vault and
yeah.
never looked at again. I was sort of bereft after the last experience, which was a co-write with one of Jay's really good writing partners. And Jackson said, Mom, why don't you write a novel? You've always wanted to. It's a lifelong dream. And I said, yeah, why don't I? That's how fast I answered the question. But then I mused about what this novel could be and who the protagonist could be, and I thought maybe someone in showbiz, maybe someone in Hollywood, and then I thought, wait a minute, I know what it's like to be in the music business, but also to be a musician. Maybe the character should be a musician. And then it just kind of went from there. And about a week after I was like boring Jackson to death with pitching him a million story ideas, he said, Mom, tomorrow morning, just open your computer first thing in the morning, stare at the blank page, and just start.
Just write.
I did exactly what he said.
Yeah.
I wrote two pages, just sort of free association. I called up my parents, made sure they were witness. So Jackson, Sam, Jay, and my parents, I read aloud what I wrote. It's nothing of it is in the book, but it was a start.
Was it the beginning of Jane?
It was the beginning of Jane, who wasn't quite Jane yet.
Okay.
I knew she was someone in showbiz, and I toyed with the idea of an actress, but then I thought, oh no, I'll make her a musician. I know I can maybe pull back the curtain on the music business and see how that works out.
She says about herself, she wants to be fearless, daring, unabashedly sensual, continuously music. And she is.
Yeah, that's when she's in bed with the fictional boyfriend. But you pulled from that.
Yeah.
All things that she would want.
Yeah.
Yeah, why not? Don't we all?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's talk about, so there are two things that I think propel the story, and they're both men. And one of them is this man she meets on an airplane.
Mm-hmm.
He's British. He teaches at Oxford.
Yeah.
Deliciously hard to know or deliciously impossible to know, right?
He's
very kind, but there's some mystery there.
Yeah.
And then there's this other guy, Jonesy, who is a big superstar musician,
mm-hmm.
who actually wrote the one hit that Jane had.
Yeah.
And they haven't been in contact for years.
Yeah.
And now, out of the blue, he wants her to do something, to
perform
with her in some way. But he's mysterious, and he's not letting on how that's going to be.
Right.
And what I love is that these two characters are foils for one another, but at the same time, they both drive her crazy with something that they're hiding.
Yeah.
And so talk about the appeal that you found in finding this Jane, she's just going crazy. Like, what are these What are these two people in my life all of a sudden,
right,
one who she's romantically intrigued by?
Yeah.
What are they hiding?
That's a really good question, because when I was crafting the story, I kind of drilled down and used two books that were very impactful in my life. One was Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte, and the other one was the book Rebecca by Daphne du Maurier. And I kind of studied those books. I listened to audiobook versions of them, and they had similar themes of like, will the ghosts of our past, whatever those ghosts are, haunt and threaten our ability to have a real meaningful love relationship with someone. So it's like about trust. It's about overcoming the ghosts of our past, which we all have in some way, shape, or form, whether it's just something we feel personally about how things have gone in our life or an actual situation with another human being. So those themes and those books were very much a part of the writing of This Bird Has Flown.
And Jane mentions Jane Eyre.
Yeah.
At, I think, a couple of different times.
Probably.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm at that point where I had to let go of the final version. You have a galley version.
Oh, has it changed significantly?
Well, no. But
I hope
was
I get
like,
it right.
Wait, you have the galley? There's typos in there.
I like the typos.
The typos are okay.
Yeah, you're like, okay. Somebody was writing this. A human being wrote this.
Yeah. Yeah. But I was thinking, you were talking about having kids and something. What were you saying backstage? Because I was thinking that the way I'm feeling right now, where the book is really out of my hands, I can no longer revise a sentence. And I was thinking it's kind of like giving birth and all that. There's a kind of anxiety that you feel once the thing is in the world.
Yeah.
And you're like trying to make sure it doesn't trip and fall. And.
But with a kid, you can kind of be like, hey, don't do that, or don't be like that. They don't listen, but you can try to be like that.
Yeah, I know.
You can't go back and edit the book once it's published.
No, I know.
But you can try to edit your kid.
You can try to edit your kid in the best possible way.
Absolutely.
And that's what I did with the
book.
But
you actually maybe do damage when you try to edit your kid.
If you edit too much,
you
could just edit it to death. Not the kid, but the book. I'm talking about the book. You could just edit that motherfucking thing to death. Sorry. Sorry, you said, I asked permission, because sometimes these F words just fly out of my mouth.
I think we said only swears.
Okay, sorry. But so, you can. Yeah. You could edit the thing to death.
So you were talking, your kids are both out of the house, and you've been married a long time, right?
What day is it? It's April what?
13th.
I can't do math. In 4 days from now, it'll be 30 years married to Jay Roach. Jay Roach. Where are you? He's somewhere. 30 years.
So look, I know, and I'm not going to be the guy who's like, is this book about you? I know it's not. But here's what I find. How could you, this Jane has all of the things when you first fall in love with somebody, and you have a crush on somebody, and you think, did I just say something wrong? Or what are they thinking? Or what are they worried? Are they in love with somebody else?
Yeah.
All of these things that Jane goes through, that we all went through when we were falling in love with the people we fell in love with.
Yeah.
Was it hard for you to kind of channel those feelings that, you know, you've been married for 30 years.
Yeah.
Like, to find that in Jane. Like, I know it's another character, but.
Yeah. I mean, the writing process has been so unexpectedly interesting, all-consuming in my, just taking up all my brain energy. I would say that I would feel, I felt tethered to her emotions, totally. You know, if she was having a hard time, I felt that. I had to actually feel it while I typed, you know, on my computer. And I had great empathy for all of the characters in the book. But of course, Jane, you know, she's the first person narration throughout. So that's such a good question. No one's asked me that.
But it's like, I, you know, you try to think, what was it like when I was 20? What was it like when I was 30?
Yeah.
Like, it's hard. It's hard
to do that. Well, I just lost myself in it. I one of the ways that I've sort of crafted to describe it is that, and it really makes me sound like I'm psychotic, but there was a kind of psychosis, mental break from reality. So I would go on these walks, music would trigger my characters to start talking to each other. I mean, I wasn't intending to go on a walk and be like trying to type on my phone what they were saying so that I didn't forget it an hour later.
You couldn't escape it. The book was in your head.
I couldn't escape it. I had to have a pad and pen by the bed because I would wake up in the middle of the night and have a thought and have to write it down. So I developed like a technique for not, because the first few times I thought, that is a genius idea. I'll never forget it. And then 5 minutes later, I'm like, what was that? I had no idea. And I would vex and, you know, pace around. So that's how I developed that technique.
Let's talk about the music that goes back and forth between the characters. Because obviously there's a lot of music in the book. Jane is a musician.
Yeah.
But there's this other thing in which music and specific songs become the way Tom, who's the British man, and Jane, not fully communicate, but it is a shorthand for their communication. And that struck me as very real.
No, I know. So music was so much a part of the writing. Like I said, I would be on my walk. This playlist started to grow during the course, and it would really be like a movie screen in my brain would come down, and I would see where they were in a room together. I would see the expressions on their faces as they had these conversations with each other. They just started talking. Like, it's like hearing voices in your head. That's what I'm saying.
But it would be a way to convey an emotion.
Yeah, yeah. And I dedicated the book to music lovers and lovers everywhere. So I knew that the music part became so integral to the writing and to the excitement that I felt. And I would listen to a song and I would be like, and it would find out that I would name a chapter after that song.
Which happens over and over again.
Yeah. So, and I have a playlist. If you go to my Spotify page, it's definitely on Spotify. Joni Mitchell took one song off of Spotify, so it's not there anymore.
Yeah, she doesn't like Spotify.
I know. I was very sad about that, but I know. So
Neither does Dr. Dre.
I know. But a couple of the songs aren't on the playlist, but it's only, you can find them somewhere else if you want. But yeah, music kind of was a companion, actually, and an inspiration all the way through. But it kind of makes sense because for me, I like to say music is the beginning, middle, and end of every day. I when I set out on my walk, I'm always playing music. I play music in the house.
You going back to old stuff, new stuff?
I need to know more new stuff because I tend to default to stuff that almost is like, it's almost like a pill. Like, yeah. I listen to Prince's Let's Go Crazy a lot in the morning, but it's like a prayer. You know, he says, dearly beloved, we're gathered here today to get through this thing called life.
Yeah.
That's a great way to start your day. It's a go-to, you know? Feel free to do that yourself.
There's a lot of sex in the
book.
Yeah,
lots of sex. And like to write about sex.
But what I like about it is it covers two things. It covers both the way I think women are portrayed in the music industry, including how Jane was presented at the beginning.
Yes.
But there's also a lot of Jane talking about her own desires, her own body. I'll quote one line that I love. She's got a friend and her manager named Pippa, and who always wears sexier underwear.
Yeah.
I don't know why there's so much underwear, but
you have to wear it every day or not.
And this is what Jane is thinking, what you wrote. She really did wear sexy underwear every day. I found that both unthinkable and honestly a little aspirational.
Yeah.
What a great line.
Yeah, because I know people who do wear aspirational underwear. And I'm always so thrown by it. And I don't want to get too graphic here, but like thong underwear.
Yeah.
Like that's not
comfortable.
Not comfortable.
Yeah.
I don't believe it.
No.
That they are.
And that's why guys, except for some Europeans, don't wear thong underwear.
Like, wouldn't you be so aware of it all day long?
All day long, yeah. But to the more serious point, you present both ends of sexuality. There's the way society wants women to be perceived, often male-dominated society, and then the way Jane and Pippa both view their own bodies.
And also the way Jane grapples with the sense that because her hit was, she's a one-hit wonder, and the hit is like around 10 years before, she feels like there's this imperative to be that person, even though she's evolved into being a much different person, or there's aspects to her that are different, but she feels that she has to deliver on that. And that's something that I kind of relate to because, you know, I'm so old now that it doesn't really matter. But there was a period post Bangles where I felt like I had to keep people expect you to be that person that they remember when they first discovered you. And you know, now I wear pants. this is a big, big step for me. I wear pants.
You mentioned that your son was like, now it's time to write that book.
Yeah.
That you always wanted to write?
My whole life.
Yeah.
My whole life. But you have to kind of one day say, okay, give yourself permission to try something new. Honestly, I've always been do-it-yourself. In the 80s, like in the beginning of the 80s, when I was desperate post-college to start a band, I would just make flyers. I drew flyers. I went to the Xerox store, set them in record stores. I brought them to the Go-Go show and the Whiskey a Go-Go, and they got thrown in the trash. And I stuck my hand in the trash and tried to rescue them. But yeah, and that's how I met them. I advertised myself in the newspaper, and that's how I met my bandmates.
So when you met
Vicky and Debbie Peterson.
When you met Vicky and Debbie,
yeah.
Was it through the ad in the paper or the flyer that you put at the Go-Go show?
It was an ad that I put in the paper that their roommate answered. They had just fired their roommate, who was their rhythm guitarist.
That
and
had to be awkward to live together.
Yeah,
after that.
Tell me about it.
Yeah.
So I answered this woman named Lynn's ad, and Vicky was the one who picked up the phone because it was like old school, like a rotary phone. Can you imagine? Like plugged into a wall, rotary phone. And I said, oh, I'm calling for Lynn. I'm looking for a bandmate. I'm a guitar player. I want to start a band. And I got on this long... At first, Vicky said, oh, we started schmoozing a little on the phone and there was a connection. But she didn't want to step on Lynn's toes when I was calling her ad. But then I think I just got up the nerve to try Vicky again, because after I talked to Lynn, I thought, no, she's not obsessed with 60s music. This is the 80s. I wanted to do very much 60s, jangly 60s pop, you know. And Lynn had other ideas. So I just decided to try Vicky again, and that was it. That we immediately connected musically. So then she and her sister Debbie, who's the drummer in the Bangles, came over to the garage of my parents' house where I was living post-college. It had a little bathroom and shower, but it was a garage.
Yeah.
It was cold in there. I had a Debbie Harry standee from the record store and lots of cool stuff in there. But it was not great. But they came with microphones, and I had never really sung like with a drummer and another guitar player plugged into amps with microphones. So I went up to the mic and I did this. Oh, you can't really hear it. And they just started laughing. They started laughing at me. She's so green. You know, and I was like, I didn't care though. I was kind of shameless about it. But I hadn't done that. But the crazy thing was we decided to play White Rabbit by Jefferson Airplane. And whenever I would hear that song, I would think it's so complicated. But it's only two chords over and over again. It's just there's the minor to major or something that sounded very difficult.
And how did it sound when you played it?
It sounded awesome. Yeah. It sounded awesome, like, oh my God, I'm playing White Rabbit. These two girls just taught me how to play it. It's easy, and it was cool. And then my mom was like, you sound like a band. And
what a great thing to say.
Yeah, and we looked at each other, and I always describe that night as being, we may as well have run off to Vegas and gotten married that night in an Elvis chapel or something, because that's how... a leap of faith it was. It was a blind date with the Peterson sisters. And we have been a band for decades now. Yeah.
So I'm an MTV generation kid. The big songs, Manic Monday, Walk Like an Egyptian, Eternal Flame, they're like implanted in my brain, right?
Oh, thanks. I'm glad. Sorry.
No. I love those songs, but it wasn't until later that I went back and listen to the Bangles' first EP.
Oh,
and
I
then
love...
all over the place.
Oh, cool.
And those albums are incredible.
Thank you.
And they're that 60s inflected power pop. Do they still have a special place in your heart?
Always.
Yeah.
And I don't know whether I just got lucky that I grew up in the 60s. Don't feel bad if you didn't grow up in the 60s and you're a lot younger. It's all good. But it was a pretty golden era, I think. I had a really interesting childhood. I'm really, really grateful to my parents. In 1964, also, this might have instilled a lifelong obsession with that music and the music of the Beatles. The Beatles actually went to a party down the street from us, and all the kids in the neighborhood, it was a charity. It was when they were in town to do the Hollywood Bowl shows.
Okay, so what year is that?
So this is 64.
Okay.
So I was 5.
Yeah.
And I literally was, there's newsreel footage you can find on YouTube of when the Beatles were in Brentwood, and you can see the street that I grew up on was Avondale, and they were all there, all the kids, they choked the whole street with kids from everywhere in the neighborhood to try to just catch a glimpse of them.
Awesome.
But this early obsession with the Beatles as a child, you know, I think that's sort of informed the sound of the Bangles and why our music was always very much inspired by 60s music and a bit 70s.
As the band got bigger and then got to the point where it was one of the biggest bands in the country, if not the world, did life speed up or slow down?
I think it sped up.
Yeah.
I think it sped up. Unless it was something that I didn't want to do, then it would slow down. But I think it was, now I think just going on a book tour, it's not hard exactly. I don't want to be like, poor me, it was hard being on a tour. But just the amount of just having to figure out where you were, what hotel you were in. I mean, it was just nonstop for like 7 years.
Also in the book, and this is Jane, I know, but I wonder if it was true for you. She's talking about having to go back out on tour and remembering when she would be at festivals and would have to, for example, pee in a Dixie cup.
Yeah.
Is that true? Have you ever peed in a Dixie cup?
I definitely have.
Yeah.
More than once. But Julianne Hatfield, I read her memoir, and I remember there was a thing about having to crouch in a corner in a club, somewhere. Yeah. The unglamorous side. There's definitely moments where Jane is recalling unglamorous moments.
You had
with
another,
Dixie cups.
You did an interview with the New York Times, and you said they asked who would direct your life, and maybe your life in the 80s.
Oh.
And you said...
Or who would write my my biography.
Yeah,
I think I said John Waters.
You said John Waters because of your dating life in the 80s.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is great, I don't have to go too far into it, but that's a great line.
Yeah. Oh, thanks. I love John Waters. I used to, besides being an absolute music junkie, I've always been a film obsessed.
Yeah.
And there was a cool art house theater near my house growing up called the New Art. And my brothers and I, mostly my older brother and me, we lived at the New Art. We lived there. And so Pink Flamingos, is it Female Trouble, all the John Waters movies were on pretty much every weekend in the evenings. And all the great New Wave films and the Italian New Wave and noir and all that kind of stuff.
Does that still exist in L.A.?
Yes.
A theater like that?
Yeah. There's two or three in L.A. that are really great.
That's
art
cool.
House movie theaters, yeah.
You've talked about your parents a little, and you just talked about film, and I can't not ask. Your mom was a filmmaker and an artist. Your dad was a psychoanalyst. I can see how your mom influenced you. Did they both influence you?
Very much so.
Yeah.
I feel very grateful because the household that I grew up in was very vibrant, and because my dad was a shrink, he just decided early on that he wanted to raise us three kids differently than his own childhood, that he wanted us to be free to talk or ask about anything. Because my mom was so artsy and my dad, they both were film buffs. They would just take us to movies like, you know, Midnight Cowboy or something, you know, like when we were kind of young. And the idea was like, if you have a question about something, I will answer truthfully. I won't, you know, pretend something's something that it's not. You know,
and
I'll just explain
it. And
encourage
you to make your own stuff too.
Yeah, and because my mom was always making things, sculptures, collages, painting, everything, the whole house was like her art project, that I just also drew and painted. And, you know, I graduated from Berkeley, UC Berkeley, as an art major.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, I'd been in the dance department. I was playing music with David Roback, who went on to form Mazzy Star. That's what the stuff I did at Berkeley sounded like. So I was always making stuff. And I think my childhood set me up to feel like it was okay to do that.
So I've got to ask, we're in Chicago. I watched a movie this week. Your mom co-wrote.
Yeah.
You're in it.
Yeah.
Stony Island.
Yes.
I don't know how many people
Jackson's
know this film.
It.
It's so 70s.
It's so
Chicago
70s. So
it's
Chicago.
Delightful.
It's about blues musicians from the South Side. My friend Ray Dawn Chong is in it, the daughter of Tommy Chong. And she was like a teenager. We were roommates during the making of
you
that.
You had to be a teenager then, too.
I was, yeah, I was like 17. I was 17, and she was like 15.
And it's all about a band, or trying to get the band together and then get a gig.
Get the band together. I know.
What's the Hoffs Chicago connection?
My mother, she grew up in Chicago. My grandfather, was Rabbi Ralph Simon at a conservative temple in Hyde Park called Rote Faith Tzedek. Did I pronounce it close to? And it's still there. And he was kind of an icon in the Jewish community, particularly in Hyde Park. But he would do the Hanukkah blessing on TV every year.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he did.
Did your parents meet here?
My parents met at Yale.
Okay.
Yeah.
You have an album out too.
Yes, I do.
And I want to hold it up. It's The Deep End.
Yeah.
And it's a collection of covers.
Yeah.
And you've had several solo records. Some include originals, some are covers, some are with, not solo records, but they're with Matthew Sweet.
Yes.
One of my favorite ever songs is Different Drum.
Oh,
I love your cover of it.
Thank
so
you.
So much. What makes a good cover song?
That is such a good question. Well, for me, because the way I got into music, I'm completely self-taught. It's the same as the book. I've never taken a class. I can't read a musical chart. It's embarrassing. But I'm really learned folk style. So and from singing along to albums. And I'm sure lots of musicians, you know, like me are untrained. But I learned from mimicking albums, but also learning chords from friends on the schoolyard and that way. But I guess so you're asking why covers?
No. What makes a good cover? Like
what makes a good cover?
Yeah.
Okay, well, one that you love to sing.
Yeah.
One, I think there's a story inside of every song. One that you think, for me, the bar has to be, I have to feel that I can do a song justice, otherwise I shouldn't dare try it, you know, but I'm willing to try anything, and sometimes, you know, I just don't feel I'm gonna do it justice, so I won't do it. But in the case of this album, I really, you know, there were some new songwriters that I was discovering because I worked with Peter Asher, the great producer who did, you know.
Who knew the Beatles, right?
Knew the Beatles. Yeah. I mean, Paul McCartney lived at his house.
Incredible.
With his sister Jane Asher, who's an actress from the 1960s. And then Peter was the first president of Apple Records when they started it. And he went on to work with, I mean, he produced so many famous albums, like Heart Like a Wheel and Prisoner in Disguise, to Linda Ronstadt Records. But I think it was the first few James Taylor records, too. So Peter and I would get together. This was during the pandemic. We kind of made a little bubble. And a lot of the players who played on those albums played on this record. And for me, in terms of feeling if I deserve to sing a cover, if I can, you know, tell the story that's inside that song, if I can feel those feelings and emote and sing the, and do it justice, then I feel that I, that's the bar that I have to, I feel there's a high bar and I have to meet it, you know?
The album's great.
Thank you.
The album's great. You, during your solo career, you were also in another band, Ming T.
Oh, yeah.
So that's the Austin
Powers
band.
I love Ming T.
So just, what's the order of operations here? Your husband directed the films.
Yeah.
Was Mike Myers developing the character?
Yes.
Okay, so go. You tell
so
me.
So Ming T, you're just right on the money there. Ming T was kind of, Mike felt that if he was going to be a swinging shagadelic spy in Britain, that he would have to have a band. Like, spies like that would have a band to be cool, and for his character to be cool. So we started to workshop, because I brought Mike to meet Matthew Sweet when Matthew and I were doing a show at a little guitar shop called McCabe's. Everybody met, and then we started to burble this idea of, like, writing songs together for the Austin character started to burble up, and we just started to write a bunch of songs together, you know? And then we started to record them. And then they made their way into the film.
And was your husband already attached to the movies?
Yeah. Where's Jay? I don't know where he is, but... Oh, you're over there? Oh, hi, Jay. Do you remember... Remember when me and Mike and the other members of Ming T wore wigs and the guy who's the hair, the shampoo guy, what was his name? He gave us each a case of his shampoo because the wigs were so terrible. I don't remember. Sorry. I feel... No. Mike would remember. I think it was. Is that right? I think so.
The shampoo?
Yeah, the shampoo.
The shampoo
guru.
Dude?
Yeah. So, but we
you
worked.
Met Paul Mitchell?
I think so.
Wow.
And I think he gave us
I've used his shampoo.
I know, it's really good, isn't it?
Yeah.
I know.
And conditioner.
And conditioner. Yeah. Always conditioner.
Yeah,
it's
just a little
important.
Bit, though. Just
yeah,
a
just a little dabble, dude.
Yeah.
But so we just workshopped the band, and it helped Mike be more swinging and shagadelic of a spy that he would have this band. It just was. I think it really helped him kind of build the character. And then we just found our way into the films.
You've worked with your husband in that context.
Yeah.
Whether it's you looking at his films, him looking at your book, but even beyond that, has the marriage been one, I assume, where you're just sharing what you love art-wise with each other?
Yeah. That really, thank you for noting that. Yeah, I mean, you're guessing that.
I'm guessing it.
You're guessing.
I have no
idea.
But
it's all true.
But it's an educated guess.
It's all true, yeah. I mean, I love to watch various cuts of Jay's movies, edits. I'm always really bossy about my opinions. and Jay doesn't mind, I don't think. Do you? Every once in a while, I was like, okay, you've told me that like 10 times, how important this note is. But he was so helpful. Because with my novel, because it's a very solitary act writing a novel.
Yeah, right.
It's not like going to band rehearsal and saying, I have this idea for a song, and then getting feedback. You just sit in a room for years at a time, to be honest, and alone. And you don't, you know, the first few reads of letting that manuscript out of my hand were very...
It's gonna be terrifying.
Yeah. I mean, I had a friend who was going through a rough time, and she would drive over. She was the first person that I really kind of really shared the book with, because she wanted me to read to her. And it was really kind of a mutually beautiful thing, because she was quite depressed, and she just said, read me your book. And I'm like, this draft is like 500 pages. And she's like, I don't care, read it to me. And it was such a great exercise, because we both benefited. She was like, oh God, I'm out of my head. I'm in your story. I don't have to ruminate for the hour or two that you're doing a reading for me. And I'm like getting great feedback on what she likes. And there was one whole section of the book. She's like, I don't think you need that whole section. I was like, yeah, you're right.
But I also kind of love that, like,
yeah,
investing, both of each of you investing your time in this project in a way that
it was
is
sweet.
Like symbiotic or
it
something.
It was. She got something out of it, and I got so much out of it, because she would say, I really like this. Mostly she liked stuff, but there were a couple things she said, I don't think you need that. And I was like, that's a good note. I'll take it.
Before you play a little bit, I wanna ask you one last question, which is, Jane asks, I think her asked Tom, are you Beatles or Stones?
Yeah.
So what about you?
I don't want to give away Tom's answer.
No, I won't give away Tom's answer.
Okay. Am I Beatles or Stones?
Yeah.
I'm going to have to go with Beatles, even though it's very hard. I wanted to play something on my phone if I have time.
Yeah, let's do
which
it.
Is that you brought up music and it made me think of it.
Yeah.
That
I'm not going anywhere.
You're not.
And nobody here
that.
Is going
I'm like,
anywhere.
I'm here for the long haul.
Yeah.
Music was so important in the writing of the book, as we've talked about.
Yeah.
Like inspiring me to write, inspiring this sort of cinematic feeling that I would start to see scenes in my mind. And there is one song cue that has been an important song cue in my life out of a kind of weird superstitious thing that I have when I go on planes. And this is one thing that I have in common with Jane, that she and I both, even though she's an imaginary creation, we both listen to this song when we take off on a plane. Should I play a little
Absolutely
of it?
Absolutely should.
Okay. I don't think I'm giving too much away, but it just brings me such joy. Now, I need a microphone to put it next
to. This is a fake microphone.
Oh, are you serious?
Well, where's the microphone? Here we go, yeah. I mean, it's a real microphone. It just needs a, yeah.
This deserves.
So there we
so
go.
So I'm just sharing you an example of like, how, and if you read the book, and I hope you will, how important music was both for my process of writing, but how is it on? This is the old thing. That's what we used to do. That's what I did and got in trouble with the Petersons.
You're so green, Susanna.
I know, it's so green. So this is a song cue that's in the book. So I want to make sure my volume's good. And you tell me if you can hear it. Can you hear that? Can you guess what it is? Is it loud enough? So I listen to this every time I fly in a plane, and you have to time it the bit when the drums start, when it kicks in.
While you're moving
you have up. To, yeah, you have to start right when the wheels roll. See, because when those flutes come in, you've already lifted off. You're like starting to like glide up into the clouds. And it's so perfect. And if you are afraid of flying, this is your cure.
Because how can you not have swagger?
You're channeling Shaft. He's not afraid of anything. We're talking about Shaft. Anyway. I love playing that.
Do you want to play a little bit?
Sure,
we
I'll
can
play.
Play, chat.
I don't know. I'm just going to do little things and
yeah,
here and
we'll
there.
Just we'll just keep
this
it casual.
Is, see, this is the hard part. I don't know. Wait, this is for my
Oh,
mouth.
We have to plug it into the guitar, right?
Oh yeah. Oh, it's in.
We're all good.
So, I don't know what will I do a little bit of little bits and pieces of things. Well, this is a song that I just recorded on the new record. I'm just going to play you a little bit of it. I have to move the capo up, though. And Jane kind of, this song really works for Jane as she thinks about this one character that we didn't get too much into.
No,
but
no spoilers.
Yeah. So, under my thumb, the boy who once had me down, under my boy who once pushed me around. It's down on me, yes it is. The difference in the clothes he wears down to me, the change has come, he's under my thumb. That's right. Under my thumb, he's a squirm. Boy who once
So that was both beautiful, and I love that right after we talked about Beatles or Stones, and you chose Beatles, you played a Stones song.
I know. It just had to be done. Yeah, I'm on a big Stones kick.
Oh yeah, what's your favorite era?
Well, that's really hard. I like really early Stones.
Yeah.
But I also love the Gatefold one, the Exile on Main Street.
When they're in France and just getting
I love that
totally
whole
decadent.
Album. Yeah. I mean, did you read the whole book?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I read it. I reread.
The part in the south of France. I looked at pictures of.
Oh, you did?
Keith's place there, Nelcott. There's a little Nelcott reference in the book. You have to read a lot of
Way.
I just studied that place, and that's how I invented that.
They had like a van outside.
Recording everything.
Yeah.
And they were all sweating in a basement.
Yeah.
On heroin or something. Yeah. Maybe just Keith.
Except for Mick. Mick, I think, was totally straight
Mick, now. Mick has always been straight. And also Charlie.
Yeah.
Charlie, who we lost a few years
ago. Did you meet them?
I met Keith once.
Yeah.
Keith. Yeah.
It's cool.
Yep, really cool.
Yeah.
I met Robert Plant too.
Oh yeah.
Talk about rock gods. Robert Plant used to come to see the Bangles when we were just playing clubs in the UK. And he was just, he loves to see new bands.
That's great.
One time, he came several times, and we couldn't believe it was him. We were like, is it? Is it?
Yeah, that's.
Because we were like putting on our lipstick in the van. We didn't even have a dressing room. That's how shit the club was. There wasn't even a dressing room. It was, and he would go to those kind of out-of-the-way clubs to just see new bands.
That's amazing.
I know. I feel very lucky about that. So I did that one. How about doing 6 o'clock already? I was just in the middle of a dream. I was kissing Valentino by a crystal blue Italian stream. But I can't be late. I guess I just won't get paid.
Prince came to the Bangles with that song. Came to you.
Yep, came to me.
What happened?
And the Bangles. Well, it was so weird because I was really late to the party with Prince. I would always hear people saying, oh my God, Prince, so great. But I hadn't heard any of his records until I was driving in my car, and when Doves Cry came on, I went, this is Prince. And so then, a little bit later, I may not have the, well, he heard our song, Hero Takes a Fall, which was
on All Over the Place.
And our first Columbia record, but it wasn't like a big hit, it was a college radio hit, but it was a song that Vicky and I had written in the same garage that I was living in when I met them. I was still living there, so that early on.
With the Debbie Harry standee.
With the Debbie Harry standee. It was just a garage converted. So it was very funky. And we wrote that song in the garage. And then Prince loved it. So all of a sudden, cut to like early, like probably maybe 84, I want to say. I'm on stage at the Palace, which is a fantastic venue across the street from the Capitol Records building, which is iconic architecture.
Super famous, yeah.
And I had heard some little rumblings that Prince was coming to see us, but I didn't, you know, I kind of put it out of my mind. And all of a sudden, we're starting Hero Takes a Fall, and he just appears. Like he did, the way Tom Petty orchestrated the While My Guitar Gently Weeps.
That's incredible.
Because
I
talked to Tom about that because I did his radio show. It's a much longer story, but He knew that Eric was going to be there, and you know, this one and that one and that, all famous, great guitarists who do amazing solos. But he said, Prince, I don't want you to be just standing there waiting your turn.
Yeah.
Just stay in the wings. It was all orchestrated by Tom. And so when that moment came, he just gave him a signal and he came out. And if you haven't seen the footage of that performance.
Was it the Hall of Fame or was it?
It was the Hall of Fame. But it is like a supernatural, that's the genius.
He blows our.
And that's what I, standing on the stage playing Hero Takes a Fall and just doing my rhythm part and watching him solo, it was supernatural is the best word that I have for it. It was so extraordinary. Yeah.
Was he knowable? Like
knowable?
Could you have like, hey, what's going on?
He had a unique way of communicating, very friendly. Very wonderful. I've stumbled upon this little clip, and I don't have it. Like, oh, I might have it in my phone, because I was thinking about it. I've been doing a lot of interviews, and you know, it comes up. There's a possibility that I could find it, but I'll just paraphrase what it was. So it was. We played the Palace a couple of times. It might have been the night that he did that solo on Hero Takes a Fall. But first of all, just picture you're me and you're in a young band and it's your first album and this is a song you co-wrote and Prince starts playing on it. You know, Prince comes to your show and plays something that no one on earth could play like that. So then there was always at the Palace kind of like an upstairs room where you could go after the show, and it was kind of like a bar.
Okay.
And so I was sitting with him in the booth and like having a conversation with Prince. It was so interesting.
Yeah,
and then
wow.
He had a lot of bodyguards and stuff kind of around, and I was like, whoa, that's kind of wow. I'm sitting there and there's a couple of bodyguards. And I said something, he said something like, I'm not going to get this right, but like, what happens when the clock strikes 12? It was like a Cinderella reference. And or maybe I said that, and he said something like, the bodyguards will all turn into rats.
Nah, that's
and,
funny.
You know, I didn't nail that story, but it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter. It was just that I was telling a journalist that, and he goes, stop. That's the sentence. You were sitting in a booth with Prince. And I was like, yes, I was sitting in a booth with Prince. Just that alone.
Yeah, like Prince sits in booths?
Yeah, he sits in booths and he talks to you and you're going, oh my God, I'm just sitting
And then
next
the song to... came later?
Yeah, so then cut to the next album. We're working on the next album. And there's a husband and wife engineering team that worked at Paisley Park a lot. So we were working with David Leonard, and Peggy Leonard was down the street at the sort of bigger, better version of Sunset Sound. We were at Sunset Sound Factory,
okay.
Sister studios, but
that's like J. Crew and J. Crew Factory.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. And so I get this call that I'm meant to drive over to Sunset Sound, the fancier one, the regular J. Crew. And I go drive over to the regular J. Crew to pick up a song that Prince has for me, and I have the very cassette that I got that day. It was on a cassette.
Okay.
Yeah, it had the little C sign with the little like copyright thing in red, and in red Sharpie it said Manic Monday and Jealous Girl. Now, weirdly, I have rewound through the tape, and Jealous Girl used to be on there, but it just sort of evaporated off the tape. And
happens.
I don't know why.
That happens to tapes.
Is it?
Well, my son is 12 and he wants to collect tapes now.
Yeah.
And we'll buy them, and I would say a quarter of them work.
And I listened for like an hour to nothing on the other side. It wasn't there anymore.
Huh.
I know, it evaporated.
Or maybe Prince wanted it to evaporate.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe. Okay, what am I going to do now? I'm going to play another thing. How many have I done? Two.
Two.
Oh, I guess I should do this one. Speaking of, wait, no, that's 5, 7. I'm going to do 8. Sorry, I have to count. Okay. It's in tune enough, I think.
Sounds good to me.
Okay.
Close.
Close your eyes, give me a hand, darling. Do you feel my heart beating? Do you understand? Do you feel the same? Am I only dreaming? Is this burning an eternal flame? I believe it's meant to be, darling. I want you when you are sleeping. You belong with me. Do you feel the same?
You love.
Yeah.
What's up there other than Shaft, of course?
Yeah. Shaft is very high up. Oh my God. I mean, I should just look at things on my phone.
Yeah, like, do you have on Spotify like the whatever that playlist is, like on repeat? And
I just have like ones that I've made for myself, but I have to just get to my. I would have them here. Let me just see, like, playlists that I have. Ah, oh, there's so many. I've posted some of them. If you, I'm just trying to find the playlist part. Shoot, I'm only seeing my stuff. Anyway, so many songs.
Give me a few that you can't, I mean, you couldn't live without. The world would be worse without.
Son of a Preacher Man, Dusty Springfield.
Yeah.
If you listen to it, do me a favor. Check out the very end. There's this thing that I used. I made Peter Asher do, but he loves it, on one of our songs. There's a thing at the very end of Son of a Preacher Man where the drummer is playing what's called the bell part of the drum.
Okay.
And it's just this little syncopated, she's singing Son of a Preacher Man, and the drum is, it's, just check that out. Make a little note in your phone.
So when you love a song, do you analyze it kind of?
Without knowing that I analyze,
yeah.
That I'm analyzing it, I just go, I wait for that little part and it sends me. There's just little things in a vocal performance do you feel like that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
But
do
I
you
don't...
guys? Yeah.
What can a great song or great book, great novel, what can it do? What do you think it can do at its best?
I think it connects our the humanness of it, the humanness of the story, the vocal, the performance, the emotion living inside of the song. I think stories, I think storytelling, songs are storytelling, a way of sharing our humanity with each other. I don't mean to sound like too pretentious in saying that, That's actually what was one of the themes in writing the book, is that all these people, we're just all these people on, well, I like to say, this planet we called Earth, and we're just putting one foot in the front of the other and trying to live well, to be a good person and to connect with others, because it's the connections between us. And I think music is one of the most magical ways to connect with a person, but all forms of art, I believe. This is why I'm obsessed with art, all forms of it. It could be a painting, it could be a film, it could be a poem, it could be a song. The stories inside of them, the feelings inside of them. I mean, I know that I can listen to a movie I mean, I cry very easily. There's a thing about the crying gene. Yeah. Some families have it. My family has it.
Oh, with life or art or both?
It could be anything. Like, I can make my father, who just turned 90, cry. Jackson knows this. If I just say two things, I could say Bubby, which is the name of his grandmother, and it works like that. His face is, or Ebbets Field, which is where he used to go with his brother who passed away from Alzheimer's, Mal. And he can't say Ebbets Field or Bubby without crying. Yeah. If I say it, he's just like, it's like clockwork.
Did he follow the Dodgers out to L.A.?
The Dodgers moved to L.A., I guess it was 57, am I right? Any baseball? That's when my parents moved to L.A.
They're like, we got to go too?
We're like, okay, the Dodgers are coming with us. Like, this is magical thinking.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Will you play one more thing before
we
go to
play?
Some questions from the audience?
Okay, yeah.
Or how many you
no,
want.
No, I don't mind. I'll play this. I love this song, and this is a song that's mentioned in the book that I just taught myself. So I'm just going to check my tuning.
Yeah.
Because I care. Not that much, but just enough. No, no, I do. I hate tuning. It's such an annoyance. Oh, there you go. It's always the B. Okay. I think that'll work. Okay, so I've been really enjoying. You know, because of the pandemic, I found myself, I was home so much, partly because my parents are so old and I just wanted to keep it really safe when I visit them. But I just found myself playing and posting things online. So this, and teaching myself songs. And so this was one of them.
I don't care if Monday's blue, Tuesday's gray and Wednesday too, Thursday, I don't care about you, it's Friday, I'm in love. Monday you can fall apart, Tuesday, Wednesday, break my heart. Oh, Thursday doesn't even start, it's Friday, I'm in love. Saturday, wait, and Sunday always comes too late.
Chicago Humanities Festival staff, do we have any questions from the audience? Does anybody have any questions for Susanna? I'm not in charge of picking folks, so don't blame me.
That's right.
Yeah, blame Nikki.
Good evening, everybody. We're going to be walking around with a mic.
Oh,
my counterpart is over here to the right. Please raise your hands, and please keep it brief. Susanna would love your compliments. Ooh. However, we've got a limited amount of time, and we want to get as many questions in as possible, okay? Great, we'll start right in the front here. Thank you.
Thank you for your music, your gifts, and for being here.
Thank you.
Assuming we take out the three gimmies, I think, the Beatles, the Stones, and Prince, if you woke up tomorrow, like in the movie Yesterday, and you could own anyone's music catalog, who would you possess?
Whoa, I don't even know. I mean, I could own anyone's music catalog? I have to say Beatles. But I wouldn't want the responsibility of it. Yeah, I think that would be so hard to know.
Did Michael Jackson own it for a little bit?
I think so.
He did, yeah.
I think it would be too much pressure on me.
Yeah.
I don't like pressure. I find it very overwhelming. But thank you for your question. I'm going to let somebody pick because I don't want to have to.
Yeah.
I don't want
to. Get back here.
Hello.
Hi.
So, hey, I'm Mike.
Hi, Mike.
When I was a kid, I got my first job at Kids R Us, which is the clothing department of Toys R Us. And they would play these four-hour corporate tapes. You'd keep hearing these songs.
I'm sorry.
No, it was not your song.
Okay, phew.
But I would keep hearing this song that I'm 16 years old. I'm enamored with the song by the Lightning Seeds.
Oh.
And I keep hearing this fucking song. I'm 16 years old. It's called All I Want. And I fell in love with it probably the same way.
All I want to do.
Are you going to go higher? Listen. Should I go low? But can you fucking play 30 seconds of it? Because I got to reckon we fell in love with it the same time.
I love that song.
It was my first job. I'm at Kids of Rock. I'm at Kids of Rock.
Yeah.
Russ.
I have it on there.
Then I found out, but you did a version of it.
Me.
All I Want.
Yeah. Am I the only person who's covered it? I love covering songs.
I think so.
I have it on here.
My question is,
okay,
can you play 30 seconds of it?
Yeah. Fuck yeah. Wait, but I want to find theirs. Wait, Lightning Seeds. I'm sorry, give me 1 second. We need to get this right. So you want to hear their version? Oh, you want to hear my version? What album is it even on? Sorry, no. No, I'm happy to do it. I'm just really bad with tech. Everyone in my family knows this. All I Want. Oh my God, sorry, it's taking me so long. I should just go to that album. I think it was this, what album was it on? Oh, thank you. Okay, so I'm finding myself on here, which
is
also embarrassing. Which album was it on? Oh, the self-titled. Oh, here we go. Should I do it into this thing again like I did before? This is handy. Where's the speaker? On the bottom?
Can't ignore or hide away. Here. Can't escape from the things that line our way. Take it, leave it, break it.
I love this song.
Anyway, you can't get back to yesterday. All I want, all I wanna do, you better listen. From now on, stop what's going on, stop what's going wrong. You better listen. From now on,
coincidence. I like the little ding there.
It's just like people say. Tomorrow's just so open up your eyes. Never hesitate.
I'll sing with myself.
I like the duet, yeah.
All I want, all I wanna do, you think you listen. From now on, sleeping in the dark, dreaming of the stars, we keep on the wish on.
Well, that's good.
Beautiful.
We're getting creative.
Do we have any other question?
Yes. Next question right
question,
over here.
Yeah.
Hi, Susanna. I'm David.
Hello.
I was wondering about the song September Girls when you did the cover of that. That was my first kind of experience with Big Star, and I'm sure you're a big fan. I was wondering if you ever met Alex and maybe know what he thought of
it. I went to see him at McCabe's. I know Jody Stevens
Don't
really well. Oh, it makes me want to play a little of that song.
All right.
Just because I haven't played it in a long time, but let's see what happens. So it's like, oh, I'm going to get it right. Does that sound right? It's really out of tune. Does anyone care?
September girls.
Let me get this a little better.
Do so much. I was your much. Till we touched. I love you. Well, never mind. I've been crying all night.
Beautiful.
That's a bit of
beautiful.
That.
I love it. What a great. Thanks. What a beautiful song.
Thanks.
I don't know where we're picking.
Next question over here.
Hi, Susanna.
Hello.
I'm Mike, too.
Hi, Mike.
Thanks for playing Eternal Flame. I lost my virginity to that song.
What?
Kidding.
Are you serious?
I was 15. I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
Wait, are you serious? You're kidding.
I'm joking.
I believed you. That's why I got voted most gullible in my middle school yearbook. I got, yeah, it was not a good, that was not.
I'm sure it's not the only time, though.
Gullibility's fun.
Yeah.
So I'm a huge fan my whole life, and growing up in the 80s, Go-Go's, Bangles, Bananarama.
Oh.
Were you guys friendly? Did you collaborate? What was the scene like with the three of you, especially women in a dominated environment?
I love the Go-Go's. I have always been friends with them. Belinda and I had some wild nights together. One night we went in search of Julian Lennon. Oh, we were both, when he had put out his records, yeah. So someone could do the math on when that came out. That was a real crazy night. But I love the Go-Go's. They're so sassy and they're so naughty. The Go-Go's were sort of naughtier than the Bangles, but we were seen more, they seemed from the outside like very, I don't know.
They were punk at the beginning.
They were punk. They were punk, but then on the Beauty and the Beat record, they were all sort of styled. It's an iconic record cover.
What did the producer slow down? He was like, we're going to slow down
Richard Goddard? Did he do that?
I don't know, but I watched the documentary, and the Go-Go's were like pissed about it. And then they're like, wait a minute, you turned us into superstars.
Oh, okay, well.
But that's a great question. It makes me so happy that the Bangles and the Go-Go's hung
out. Like I said, I brought my flyers to their show at the Whiskey, and I've written songs with Charlotte. I've hung out a lot with Belinda. We've sung together. I'm closest with, and Kathy's great, and her memoir is fabulous, too.
Just came out a couple years ago.
Yeah.
All right.
Our next question's back here. Hi, Susanna.
Hello.
Thank you for being here. I'm the Same Age Girl fan. And I used to hang out at the Palace and McCabe's and some other places. But I'm also a writer. So, you know, and at any age, we're always learning new things. So you've mentioned a few things here, but what's the most profound thing you learned about yourself in the process of writing this novel?
Oh, that's so interesting. One thing that I learned is that I love writing. And Jay would come in and go, I can't believe you're so happy writing. It's a totally new joy fest for me. I mean, I love music, obviously, and music plays a big part in my daily life. But the pure escapism of it, I found so much joy in it. Even though it's a difficult process and you have to stick to it and you have to have discipline, it was... I learned that I want to do more writing.
Are you going to write another novel?
Yeah, I would like to. I really would because, it was an unexpected pleasure to just, it was sort of brought out this kind of childlike feeling of playing with my characters, you know, like, you move over there, no, you move, you know, I don't know.
You're the master.
I was the master. Yeah. I felt some little bit of control in my own personal universe.
Did you ever fear you couldn't do it?
I never gave up. You know, I think because I enjoyed it so much that it was so pleasurable somehow. And I know that's not normal to be that happy writing. Jay would say, I've never, you know, he doesn't feel that way. Right, Jay? You're admitting that. Okay. He's miserable writing. Oh, poor Jay.
Let's do a couple more.
The next question will be over here.
Hi, Susanna.
Hello.
I'm Steve. I haven't read the book yet because it just came out, but curious about the title of the book and the reference to the Beatles.
Yes. Okay, so I didn't have a title for the longest, longest time. I was just kind of using the character's name, which is Jane Start, and just sort of slapped on there. And it was really getting 11th hour. And for some reason, during the course, I revisited a lot of childhood books during the writing of This Bird Has Flown, and I just wanted to, it was like, teach myself about writing. And so I revisited The Great Gatsby, which is one of the great novels ever. I've heard that Fitzgerald never even realized what a success it was, that maybe he he died before he was ever able to know that, which is so sad. But and then I had just see, and then I revisited The Sun Also Rises, which I'd always loved the title of that book, The Sun Also Rises, and the other Hemingway title, For Whom the Bell Tolls. And I had watched a Hemingway documentary that Ken Burns, I watch all Ken Burns documentaries. I think they are, put them on your list. They are so important to watch if you can, you know, give yourself the time. The Civil War one is unbelievable, but the Hemingway one was so interesting too, and the Vietnam one is amazing. But, and so I kept having this idea that I wanted like a little phrase. I wanted like a little phrase like The Great Gatsby or Tender is the Night or, you know, some of the Fitzgerald titles. But The Sun Also Rises was, I just always, I like the poetry of it. But my characters, the love interests, Jane Start and Tom Hardy, they have a cute thing where they both love music and they send each other song links. And I realized that there was a moment where Jane sends Tom Norwegian Wood, and the full title of Norwegian Wood is Norwegian Wood, colon, This Bird Has Flown. And there was a lot of analogies to birds and singing, sings like a bird. You know, there was a swirl of things were going around in my head, and I just wrote down This Bird Has Flown on a Post-it. And I just put it on my desk, and it was just looking at me the whole time. And then the 11th hour was like, I said to Jay, we were in the pool for some reason. We decided to take a swim. And I said, I have this title, I think. This Bird Has Flown. And there was a pause. I'm looking at his face, and he goes, oh, I like that. I like that a lot. I mean,
it works.
And then I called my literary agent. Same thing. Next day. Because I knew I had Jay in the bag with it. Jay was in the bag.
So who do you need? Who do you need to line up behind?
Well, I wanted, Jay was my go-to because he's my longtime spouse and I trust him.
Yeah.
And then with my secret name for the book. And then Sarah Burns, who's my literary agent, who came from edited a book called The Lovely Bones, which is a really beautiful book. She's very wise. She had the same thing. I said it. There was a little pause and she goes, same thing. It was just, I got Jay's response, I got Sarah's response, and then I was like, well, I'm sold on it already. So then it was just telling Little Brown. And the same thing with, I think I got this before the manual. No, this was already a done deal. When I sold the book, when Little Brown bought the manuscript, it was called The Spirit Has Flown. Yeah, it was.
Very nice.
A moment there where I missed
it. We got time for about one more, maybe two?
Yes, this will be our final question.
Final question.
Yep.
Out of my hands.
Hi, Susanna. How are you doing? This has to do with like opening acts. I saw the amazing Doll Revolution tour at the House of Blues in, I think, 2008. And your opening act was The Bridges.
Amazing. Who was it?
The Bridges.
Oh, The Bridges, yeah.
And Brittany Painter is the opening act. My question is, in your opinion, what makes a great opening act for a major band?
Oh, well, it's always a lot of pressure having been an opening band for so many years. I mean,
who
the Bangles, even when we had the number one song, and I hate saying stats and stuff. It's so embarrassing, but it's true.
Not if it's number one.
No, I know. Yeah. It was number one. It was the first time that we'd had it. Manic Monday had been a hit. It got to number two, which is almost like number one.
Almost good.
But we suddenly on tour opening for Mr. Mister.
Oh, yeah.
And it's so dates the period, doesn't it? So we're opening for Mr. Mister, and somehow we put, If She Knew What She Wants was the second single. It kind of was like a college radio hit. But then we put out Walk Like an Egyptian on a pure whim. And all of a sudden, kids in America are calling the radio stations. They want to hear that quirky song with the kooky lyrics. And while we were on tour with Mr. Mister, our song, I forget whether Was it I Died in Your Arms Last Night? What was their song? No, no.
Kyrie?
Yeah. Okay, we have a lot of 80s fans here.
Everybody.
All of a sudden, it was just kind of creeping up the charts. And by the time it hit the Christmas, Hanukkah holidays, it just froze at number one. And it became, and I hate the stats thing, but it became the biggest song of that, whether it was 86 or 87. It just froze on the charts at number one for the whole holiday season. So that was crazy. But did I answer your question, opening bands?
What makes a good one?
Oh, God, how did I digress? There's something wrong with my brain. Yeah,
just what makes a group, just the bridges were amazing. And they were so amazing that I saw them open up for Matthew.
Yeah, but what happened to them? But what happened to them?
I don't have any idea.
Me neither. So sad. Well, I just loved them when I saw them, when I heard them. That's what makes a great opening band. I mean, we opened for the English Beat. We opened for Mr. Mister. We always were the opening band. It took forever for us to headline. And then bands that opened for us, the Hoodoo Gurus from Australia opened for us. I can barely remember now because I always think of the Bangles as the opening band for those other bands.
So, listen, I just want to say that this has been such a pleasure for me. The Chicago Humanities Festival has a whole lineup this spring, so check out all of their other shows, including one I've got here on May 11th with Jonathan Eig, who's written an unbelievable biography of Martin Luther King, and the Juju Exchange, which is a wonderful Chicago-based jazz band, is also going to be playing. But right now, I just want to thank Susanna for such a great evening.
Thank you. Is it okay?
Yeah. Susanna Hoffs, everyone.